Let's turn back now to the senators, the campaign chairs, and Senator Menendez, I will begin with you. Talk about Pennsylvania. The White House backed Senator Spector. That didn't work. Assess this race now going into the fall.
Well, you've seen that you have a Navy admiral who really has a independent view, one that fights for Pennsylvanians in terms of their jobs and economic opportunity, versus someone who spent a decade on Wall Street as a derivatives trader and ultimately spent another 6 years in Congress, defending the interests of Wall Street. I'll take that matchup on any day. And I think Pennsylvania 12, the congressional election that took place, the only election in which there was a Republican against a Democrat. And that election showed very clearly in a district that John McCain won, in a district that far more conservative, where Republicans went after Barack Obama and Nancy Pelosi, and our candidate talked about jobs and economic opportunity, he won. And I think you're going to see that same race, type of race, played across the country.
Is President Obama, who declined to come in for Senator Spector at the very end because the view was he was going to lose, is he an asset or a liability for Democratic candidates this fall?
I think the single biggest thing that President Obama can do to help Democrats and particularly the country as we move into midterm elections is what he has been doing. Riding this country from huge job losses to job gains, going from negative domestic growth to positive domestic growth, tackling some of the fundamental things that my colleagues on the Republican side, let fester for 8 years. I mean, the reason we had double-digit increases in health care, Republicans did nothing. The reason that we had excesses on Wall Street is because they didn't permit a cop.
Let's stay focused to Pennsylvania. Senator Cornyn, your view.
Well, I think Pennsylvania, Colorado, Arkansas, Kentucky are demonstrate on the Democrat side basically a fight between the party of big government, the Democratic Party, and the people who are running against those establishment Democrat candidates who are in favor of really, really big government. People like Mr. Conway, people like Mr. Romanoff out in Colorado, people like Mr. Sestak, who basically, as you pointed out, David, voted 98% with Nancy Pelosi and the president's agenda, which is extraordinarily unpopular. 60% of the people, I think it's 56% nationwide, believe the health care bill that my friend Mr. Menendez and my friend Mr. Sestak support, they want to repeal it because they realize we can't afford it because it raises premiums, raises taxes, and cuts Medicare in order to create a new entitlement
program.
Let
me ask about another interesting race here of a candidate who's gotten into some trouble, and that is Connecticut, the Attorney General Richard Blumenthal and his Vietnam-era service. This was the headline in the New York Times. The candidate's words differ from his history. This was an article that pointed out several examples where he had claimed that he had actually served in Vietnam when he had not. This was one example back in March of 2008.
We have learned something very important since the days that I served in Vietnam.
And in fact, he dealt with that a few days later, this week rather, at a press conference where he dealt with the story and what he meant by all of that. Was it a misstatement or something more? This is what he said.
Now, on a few occasions, I have misspoken about my service, and I regret that, and I take full responsibility. But I will not allow anyone to take a few misplaced words and impugn my record of service to our country.
Senator Menendez, is it a stretch to believe that this was just a misstatement? Do you know anybody in the military who's not extremely careful about speaking about their service and whether it occurred during wartime or not?
Look, I think the Attorney General, surrounded by veterans who had his back, as he's had their back over 20 years, clearly said, I misspoke. As a matter of fact, the article that originally came out about him in the same video, if you looked at that video later on, he says, I did not serve in Vietnam. So the bottom line is, here's someone, however, who did ultultimately enlist in the Marines, in the reserves.
But Senator, my question is very clear. Do you think people really believe it was a misstatement? Don't you know anybody in the military who's very careful about distinguishing their military service during wartime or not? I know what he said.
If you listen to the very veterans in Connecticut, they said, we knew that he did not serve in Vietnam, and we did not believe that he was deceiving.
Did he try to mislead
people?
These
are the veterans of Connecticut. But listen, I'll take a crusading attorney general who did serve in the Marines, versus John's candidate, Linda McMahon, who actually operated the World Wrestling Entertainment, which became a dirty business. She tried to intervene in an investigation on a narcotics issue in that industry. She peddled violence to kids, let wrestlers have their bodies ultimately be damaged, all for the purposes of making money. I think that that contrast in this election is one that we'll take.
Senator.
We still have a primary in Connecticut, so I don't know who our nominee is going to be. But what the public is looking for are candidates and office holders that they can trust and that have integrity. And unfortunately, I think Mr. Blumenthal has damaged his reputation as somebody you can trust by misrepresenting his record. And the only worst thing, David, I think, is then coming on and saying, oh, I misspoke, after you've been caught red-handed. It's as if he shot himself in one foot, then reloaded, and shot himself in the other.
Before you both go, I want to talk about the politics.
I guess that applies to Rand Paul, too.
I want to talk about the politics of immigration. This week, the Mexican president met with President Obama, had a state dinner. He also spoke to a joint session of Congress in which he was rather critical of the law in Arizona, a tough anti-immigration law, saying it was an invitation to racial profiling. Sarah Palin posted something on her Facebook page which seems to speak for a lot of conservatives who are defending the Arizona law. She wrote this: Arizonans have the courage to do what the Obama administration has failed to do in its first year and a half in office, namely secure our border and enforce our federal laws. And as a result, Arizonans have been subjected to a campaign of baseless accusations by the same people who freely admit they haven't a clue about what they're actually campaigning against. Senator Menendez, you have pushed this administration to pass comprehensive immigration this year. Is that possible in this political climate?
Well, I hope if John and some of our colleagues on the Republican side join us in an issue that is critically important to both the national security, the national economy, and about stopping the exploitation of millions of people, yes. But if Republicans, who have basically taken an absolute opposition to seeking comprehensive immigration reform, continue to do so, you can't have states like Arizona say Washington hasn't acted. And I've said to, you know, I've mentioned various times that the governor of Arizona should speak to her two U.S. senators and to her Republican colleagues in the Senate to make sure that they join us in an effort to make sure we control the borders and at the same time deal with the 12 million people in this country.
And Senator Cornyn, it was Senator McCain who's now talking about, you know, has an ad about completing the fence on the border. He and Senator Kennedy championed comprehensive immigration reform, as did President Bush. And it was the Republican Party, his own party, who turned away from him on it.
Well, David, I wish that the President of the United States, the President of Mexico, the Attorney General, and the Secretary of the Department of Homeland Security would have done what anybody can do with Internet access, which is to download a copy of the Arizona bill and read it for themselves. It expressly bans racial profiling. And frankly, the people of Arizona have had to step up in the absence of a sensible immigration reform plan, starting with border security. The president's budget is essentially a flat line in terms of additional boots on the ground and additional resources to secure the border. With drug wars raging in Mexico, 23,000 people have died in Mexico since 2006. This is having a spillover effect in the United States, and we've got to secure the border as a predicate to dealing
with
the larger issue.
Would you support comprehensive immigration reform this year if it included protections for the border, as it did when the Bush administration tried it, as well as a path to legal status for those workers who are here?
Well, the Bush administration made leaps and bounds working with a bipartisan Congress to improve border security, but it still is not secure. There's a lot we need to do.
So you don't think it happens this year?
I think Rahm Emanuel, as I understand, has advised the president that this is not something they should do because he's called it the third rail of politics. The president's got to take the lead,
Senator,
and then we'll work
with
him.
Will the president do it?
Well, certainly, if the president said he wants to do this, we just need some Republican support here. Look, they've talked about, John Kyle and John McCain have talked about rounding up all 41 Republican senators in opposition to comprehensive immigration reform. Well, they can filibuster then. There's no way to move forward. This is too important an issue for the national economy, for the national security. I'd rather have people know who is here to pursue the American dream and pay their taxes than to keep them in the shadows.
All right, I'm going to make that the last word. Stalemate for this morning on that. We'll continue to follow it. Thank you both very much for being here. Coming